When we talk about education, after lunch, even on a very, at a time when it's game period or so, it's very difficult. The reason is we do not give enough importance, maybe, probably, which some of my also recent findings can also support my this statement, that how much really we give, I mean, interest to ourselves, to our children, or to the society. How much value do we give? The last speaker, the today's keynote speaker, Commandant Marine Academy, ended his speech with a statement of the father of the nation. So let me also say from the statement of the father of the nation, because he was the first man who thought about the blue economy and Sonar Bangla, right? Because right from the maritime territorial waters and maritime zones act 1974 was actually suddenly done by him. And without any lot much of research, because he was a visionary leader. And that prompted the nation, because there were other problems. But anyway, we have now our legitimate right of the blue ocean and access to the sea. And subsequently, there are some positive developments which I also want to mention here. Number one is that we have access to the open sea, because it was debatable once upon a time. And I had also have done some research on delimitation of maritime boundaries and so on, so forth. And after that, you see, under the present government, there are some appreciable changes in the maritime sector. First one, because I am now representing from an association, you know, the Shipowners Association. The name has been uttered a number of times here. So Bangladesh Oceangoing Shipowners Association, right? And today, I just want to correct your last statement, the Commodore Arif's. The total number of ocean-going ship today, right today, because I was given a message by the MMD office, the 97, right? So this is the highest number the country could ever possess, total number of ocean-going ships. It's not a matter of joke, because the country was born without any owner, without any ocean-going ship proper. So, and the chairman in my team, who is working, he, in the last week, I mean, just a couple of days ago, he has signed for the largest ocean-going ship at Singapore. That will be new built. So these are the positive things. What is another positive thing? That we have a number of maritime institutions growing. Some are in the pipeline, some already developed. Maybe they are not fully equipped. The country is moving in the maritime sector. These are the indications. These are good news. And the last but not the least, the maritime university, where I was, by the present government, decided that the maritime actually university will be developed in Bangladesh. And that has been developed, and I had the opportunity to work there. And my registrar was Commodore Arif, and nice to get him here. And regarding the maritime education and at sea education, the things I started learning is how to design ships. My friend is there, Zulfikar, 46 years ago. We started learning things together, and nice to see you here also. And let me give some of my recent observations just within a short time. I'll try to talk on the areas where probably some of you have missed. Our topic is this afternoon, maritime education and training, right? So education word is there, though, but mostly we talk about seafarers and all these things. What they do, they are trained. Normally, the seafarer, a rating is trained for 6 months, if I'm correct, in NMI, because the other day he also explained it to me. 6 months training. That means, and he has to be an SSC passed national, I mean, citizen of Bangladesh. That means he has already had 10 years in the school. That means a big portion of his, major portion of his, important portion of his career or life was under the Ministry of Education. So for shipping stakeholder, I mean the number one ministry is Ministry of Shipping, but we have other couple of ministries. They are responsible for the credits or discredits, whatever. It's my feeling. If I have a computer, I put some, say, pen drive, that is an input. So what it says, if you put garbage as input, you will, it will result garbage also. So what I see, we have a lot of good news, good stories, but the last report, which I just got from OECD report, there are a list of, say, 20 countries. We spend the least amount of the GDP, less than 2% for education. Think about it. And the countries in, say, in the South Asia, India, even Pakistan, even India, they spend a lot in proportion to us. Like Tonga, Bhutan, they are almost more than 5%, and we are less than 2%. This is a point to be noted. Just, I don't want to go further about it. What I said this because we need the right maritime education to produce the right people. And if you do not produce the right person, you cannot operate the right ship, because ships are changing, so you have to adapt with it. The ships are updated, smart ships. The Bangladesh will be smart, but ships are also getting smarter. But you have to have a smart knowledge. And to run or operate a ship, what the speaker said, we need competency, and which is actually standing on three pillars. Number one is knowledge, number two is skill, and number three is attitude. How, what you want, your strength in mind. If you miss one of them, you lose. You cannot operate, because you have to operate at a very challenging situation, right? This is going to sea and earning a lot of US currency or whatever is not that simple equation. You have to have enough input for that. This is very important. We have passed a very challenging situation, the whole world, the pandemic situation, right? That has also affected us. Some people might have benefited through business and other things, and we lost many of our lives, friends, and other countries also. But see how education was affected, right? We closed our school 82 weeks, the longest period. And some of the countries, only 37 weeks, fully or partially closed schools. So that has impacted our education. So whoever are in the helm of affairs of the training institute, they have to cater these things. Because when I go for a teaching in, my, say, in a private university, I find the recent inputs are different than before COVID, right? So these are the things, because others who did not actually affect their education, naturally they will be on a better driving seat, they will operate better ships, and their demand will be more. So you have to think about it. Because why I'm talking about it? Because education is important. Why? It improves your trainability. It's not only speaking English. Chinese could hardly speak English when I started working with them around 37 years ago, first I visited China. Then education gives problem-solving capability. If you are not knowledgeable, how can you solve the problem? Your language will not speak. Then adaptability, if you are educated, your adaptability will be better, because you will know alternative strategy you can formulate. At sea, the captain is the jack of all trades, because he is the smartest guy, or chief engineer, because he will have the, all the crisis and will manage with only 15 to 20 people on board. Then, of course, fluency and language, these are there. So that's why I'm just talking that we are talking on maritime education. I have not started yet. Where is maritime education? Maritime education starts for the ratings after 16 or class 10, and for the officers after class 12, in our case. Then the game starts. And once they are actually qualified, then they go for jobs. There are a lot of opportunities because they have as already Commandant Marinetech Academy said, there are dozens of career occupations with lucrative salaries. These are the good things, and these should encourage, but we have to motivate them, right from marine lawyers, ship captains, ship engineers, these are common, then marine superintendent, marine geologists, then insurance underwriter, those who work like P&A clubs and all these things, they earn lump sum and very good salaries. These are the targets maybe, but you have to train yourself. If you cannot train yourself properly, then you just cannot survive, because the world is a place of competition. Look, last month, Daily Star, what did it say? That number of skilled personnel increased in Bangladesh from an outsider. That means we are not developing our competency. We are not developing our skilled personnel. So that has to be kept in mind. Only looking at old pictures and thinking that my grandfather was a rich person, it may not help you. 60,000 students in one maritime university. Can you imagine? You just see now in Wikipedia, you can also see, but I have seen it personally. And 60 at the minute. I just give another example. The other day, one lieutenant commander visited my office. He said that, you know, we have good number of Chinese ships and we are also building in cooperation with them. How many British ships we could build in our yards? We could not. So this is a good start. This is number one, that they had a problem with the new ship, a steering gear. The university students solved the problem and built it. Another example, in Shanghai, if there is any engineering cadet, in Shanghai Maritime University, when I visited the simulator, the engine simulator is the double of this room, I mean this floor. And there is a huge machine. The instructor said, I designed and built this machine in this university. And he meant it. That I believed it. If somebody could tell me this story, I would say that these are false. You'll see that in whole Asia, number one, first two universities from Tsinghua and this kind of Peking University. And they have 91 affiliations with, right from Harvard or whatever, MIT. They have other connections. Because for knowledge sake, because in our religion, there is a saying that Gyaner Junno, Dorka hole Chin deshe jao, bole nahi? And they are going it. Although China badnam korche, but China kase jete hocche. I found that professors from Oklahoma University, I just found my friend, he is visiting because they invite him and do good things. You see the math Olympiad, who comes first? Our boys are doing good. I love them because only thing, we are seniors, we have to take the blame. Children are good. We fail to manage them. If we cannot manage properly, teach them, they can go also up, at par with the Chinese maybe. So, sorry, I've just taken other way. Any other question? You just come up. Student, any Thank student.
You, sir, my question is that our country vessel is 97. Due to flag resistance and other owner's problem, the number of outsiders, that means owner is from Bangladesh, but the flag of resistance is outside of Bangladesh. So the number is very high. I had an interview with the Belal Ahmed sir from Singapore. He told that approximately 300 vessels are available within the world. These are owners from Bangladesh.
I don't have such information anyway. I can't comment on it.
So
the owners from Bangladesh.
Owners from Bangladesh, but flag of registry from outside.
Because we do not keep such records. Please visit us and show your documents. I don't know.
So,
because these owners, I don't think so. Some of them may have, but what I know is the ships which are flying Bangladeshi flag and our owners, there are 16 at the moment. For good number of years, there were only, say, half a dozen. Then it was 10 to 12 for, I mean, quite some time. Recently, we have some four new members. They have invested. And of course, the leading investors are, say, SS Shipping, then, of course, Magna, Akis. These are the things. And we are getting new members, but there are opportunities. As you know, in Chittagong port, yearly 4,500 foreign vessels come every year almost, you know.
Right.
So, well, it's not a small thing investing for foreign ship. And who doesn't want to have a ship? And government has to be more proactive. And I'm sorry that I would love to get some government bureaucrats here, so that for last 4.5 years, I have seen, I mean, more than three Director General of Shipping and maybe half a dozen Joint Secretary or Additional Secretary. For an issue like flag protection issue, we have been fighting for 2-3 years, maybe more, me and my chairman. Because we want that Bangladeshi owners should get certain benefit. If you do not look after the owners who are earning foreign currency for Bangladesh, how can they work? Because it's a very risky investment. It's not only buying the ship. And just one another, in my research, I found that in British territory, the owners actually are responsible for their training, recruitment of their crews, you know. Interesting. But in our case, the system is different, whatever, because our owners, not only owners, the leaders, they have to also think about the blue economy. They have to be, they have to have, like, what we call it, seaman's eye. They have to look south, that what are the opportunities. We own this much of sea, doesn't only give anything.
Sir.
Because the moment the Myanmar signed the delimitation process, they started exploring their oil, but we have not yet gone there. We're just waiting and waiting. Thanks God that some of the owners are courageous. They have invested and they are doing good. And during COVID, last 4.5 years, I have mentioned in my one of the writings that our owners have done tremendously good job. Our ship's number increased. I thought I was a bit shaken that number would go down again. Because I have a curve that, like sea wave, going up, going down, going up, going down. So we have a lot of activities to accomplish. I just don't want to so much about the training institutes, but what I want to emphasize that every, because we have some good number of also under trainees, that try to read a little bit of history. Whatever may be your profession, history tells our present also, you know your present, but you know what were the pitfalls, what were our mistakes. You can learn from there. Without history, no country can prosper. I have some, not much like them, experience of either observing or working, or I mean knowing some of the maritime countries which have, I mean, marine institutions, like our neighboring country, Myanmar. Everybody cannot go. I have seen Maritime University of India, then World Maritime University, and two of the largest maritime university in the world, Shanghai and Dalian, also Philippine institutions. I would just give a few examples before I finish, if you allow me. Actually, we started this game of learning maritime business, say, 1952. So you might ask, you could ask the question that what happened from, say, 1909 or somewhere the British did this, that. What happened? Because British ruled us for 200 years. What happened at that time, our boys or children, they were not mariners? Well, in the truth is the British people were a bit different. You see, under 200 years of their rule, hardly we can speak English better. I have seen the Filipinos, they are Hispanic. They were with the Spanish people 350 years, Spanish. And then 50 years with the Americans. And they are mariners, I find they speak, they are very fluent. They are very good in English. That's very important. So the British people used to keep their officers mostly, and very junior people from the subcontinent, maybe clerks, maybe doctors, these kind of things. So when the first Indian, Royal Indian, British period, during the British period, in 1935, they had this ship, RIMS Dufferin. That was the first, training ship. And it was in service for more than 35 years. And they started producing local mariners. 3 years course on board. Then they produced officers. And from there, there was another training ship, T.S. Rajendra. And then they came out because number was increasing. So our boys, before 1947, some of them have gone there because this was under one government. So that was the history, but probably we could not develop something. So under the Colombo plan, the Commonwealth started the Marine Academy in 1962, and the first batch came out in 1964. And from there on, the initial batches were very good product, and they have done tremendous contributions, say first 20, 30 batches. And then crisis started because there was recession, then shipping business, then owners were not much available. If now I'm just giving few examples, say ownership, when it came to the privatization, the private organizations with which I am working, they started the business, then again the BSC started falling down. So at one stage, BSC had very less number of ships, and now thanks God that there is a rise in the number of ships. It's not that just simple, because for last 4.5 years, we are in a team of working with the other stakeholder minister, like Minister of Finance and Minister of Industries, because there are certain areas, the tax, the facilities, it was not done that way. So we have tried, and we have got very good amount of benefits, and government has given a lot of positive drives for that, and the investors are also taking initiative to improve on it. Still then, the major issues what we have is that there is a statistics today that say 300,600 taka yearly we are earning through our seafarers. But if we compare to just with one country, the Philippines, is not enough. If you convert that, the amount of money is the amount, say 3 point whatever in terms of, but in billion dollar it comes 0.35 billion dollar I calculated. And Filipino per year, they just 15 times of what we earn. And Philippines is a country of 11 crore people, and we are almost 17 crore people. So in terms of population, they are less, but they are giving more, seafarers. That has to be kept in mind, that why our seafarers are not global, why our ratings are less in number. The government has done tremendous good things, that opening new institutions, but we, the business people, or the society, those who are the people who should actually work on it, and they should, give more and more opportunities to develop seafarers. There are a lot many challenges. Because of time constraint, I'm not going to go in details. If there is any opportunity, I will talk about this subject. I want to thank today's my fellow panelists or the speakers for their excellent presentation. And also, I want to thank everyone, the organizer of this expo exhibition. They have been working days and night for last few days, and for a successful event. And thank you so very much, and for allowing me to say a few words. Thank you.